In this video, I'm going to show you how to diagnose and replace a failed wheel bearing on a Volkswagen Jetta. Now, the most obvious clue is above 40 miles per hour, you start to hear a roaring noise. What that roaring noise is it could be a failed wheel bearing. Now, you also want to isolate any kind of road or tire noise first, so make sure tires are balanced, your tires don't have any kind of strange wear pattern that's causing a roaring noise, or you just have cheap tires or old tires that are just noisy. Now, a basic test you can do is to grab the steering wheel like this, grab the wheel like this and shake it like this. What you're doing is you're checking for play in the wheel hub, which is here. If the wheel bearing is worn, you're often going to find that the wheel has a little bit of play like this. Now, another test you can do is to grab the suspension strut. So, jack up the, obviously all this has to be done with the car is jacked up. Grab the suspension strut and gently turn the wheel. If you're feeling vibration through the strut or growling through the strut, it may be a failed wheel bearing that's transmitting vibrations up through the suspension. Now, another common test is to load and unload the suspect wheel bearing by turning the steering wheel while driving down the road. If you're doing 40 to 60 miles per hour, that's a sufficient speed. Make sure you don't make like really wild steering inputs. Just smooth but firm steering inputs will be sufficient. So when you turn the steering wheel to the right, what this does is it loads the left side of the car. And if the bad wheel bearing is on that side, then it'll get a little bit more noisy. If you turn the steering wheel to the left, it's going to load the right side of the car because the car is going to lean to that side. And that will increase the noise of any suspect wheel bearing. Now, the one thing you do have to watch out for is that when you load the tires, they'll also increase in noise. So to rule out any kind of tire noise, what you can do is drive from new pavement to old pavement, drive from a regular road to a bridge, and that will change the road surface. In other words, it changes the tire and road interface. If the noise increases, then, or it changes, you know, gets louder or softer, then there's a decent chance it could just be, you know, you have cheap tires, old tires, a bad alignment, something that's causing tire noise. If the noise does not change, or if it changes only a little bit, then there's also the chance that it is in fact a wheel bearing. Right now I'm on smooth pavement and I'm driving only 50 miles per hour, so there's minimal wind noise, but you can kind of really hear the humming from the wheel bearings. Again, it's not tire or road noise because I already had the tires balanced and they're all good. I've already removed the axle from this side so I can spin this freely. If you listen carefully, you can actually hear the bad wheel bearing. I can feel it in the strut. And you can kind of hear that thud 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 thud. In addition, if you shake the hub like this, you can feel the play in the wheel bearing. Now, when you loosen the axle bolt, make sure you only loosen it 90 degrees if the car's weight is on the wheels. Otherwise, you could damage the wheel bearing. So first, a nice big breaker bar in there. And loosen 90 degrees. Home. Then raise the car, remove the lug bolts, and then you can continue to loosen the axle bolt. I always use a wheel hanger when removing and installing a wheel so that the wheel doesn't drop and bang itself or scrape the wheel weights off the inside of the tire. So, as you can see, the wheel hanger just threads into one of the bolt holes. Now, when you jack up the car, make sure the weight is securely resting on jack stands. I always use at least two points where it's resting and I stuff the tire underneath the car in case it falls down. If you're not sure how to jack up your car and rest it securely on jack stands, make sure to consult a professional mechanic. On the driver's side, you have this brake pad wear sensor and you can release the plug by pulling up on that little tab. You can stick a screwdriver in there and twist it, and then pulling it apart like that. Then you have to remove the caliper. To remove the front caliper, first remove these little dust caps covering the caliper slider bolts, or the caliper carrier bolts. Then use a Torx T45 to loosen the caliper slider bolts. One here and one up here. Now, when you remove the caliper, don't let it hang from the rubber brake line. You're going to damage the brakes. Also, remember to remove this spring that holds the brake pads in place. You can just take a pair of pliers and it will pop out just like that. Once the caliper bolts are loose and you've removed that clip, try to wiggle the brake caliper like this just to press the pistons back a little bit and give you a little more play. Now, when the brake pads and rotors have worn, there'll be a lip here, and that will kind of cause the brake pads to catch on that wear lip. And it'll come out just like that and that. Make sure you take note of which side is inner and which side is the outer brake pad. Now, it's important to not let the caliper hang by the brake line, so just get a clamp or some zip ties or something and let it hang from the suspension strut, just like that. Then remove the two caliper carrier bolts. These are 21 millimeters. As you can see, that one was pretty tight, so if you have an impact wrench or a breaker bar, it would make it much easier. To remove the rotor, loosen the set screw, and it's a T30 Torx. Now, you may be wondering, why does Volkswagen use a Torx here? I'm actually glad they use a Torx here, because most rotors use Phillips head screws, and those normally strip out. As a quick tip, if you are doing a brake job on something with a Phillips head screw, always use an impact screwdriver, because it's 99% chance you're going to strip it out. Now, the rotor is pretty stuck on there, so what I'm going to do is first, I'm going to remove this, the wheel hanger, and give this a quick tap around the hub. The wheel hat. Never hit the rotor face, just hit the wheel hat to help loosen any rust. And there we go, it's loose. The bearing comes in the entire hub assembly, which is nice because you don't have to remove the spindle and send it out to a machine shop for them to press in a new bearing. The downside is it costs a little bit more, but I think it's worth it. Then remove the three ball joint bolts. It's best to mark these with paint or scratch the surface of the metal to indicate their position. If you index their position, you won't have to mess with the alignment. Once the ball joint nuts are removed, you can press down on the lower control arm, and that will separate the hub from the lower control arm. Then you have enough room to push the axle out. Now, I've loosened this axle bolt a number of turns so that there's room between the shoulder and the hub. I'm going to knock on this to help push it out. As you can see, it is moving, and that means the axle is getting pushed out. You can also take a socket, insert the socket through here, and then, you know, try to use a piece of wood or some rags and stuff them in there so that you're not damaging the axle end, but pound on the socket and use that as a drift, or use a brass punch to punch out the axle. There we go. Axle just came out and undamaged. On the back of the hub, there's these four M12 12-point bolts that hold the hub assembly to the steering knuckle. They're pretty tight, so make sure you get a nice big breaker bar. And there we go. Now, as a quick tip for these really tight bolts, feel free to use leverage here. So use a nice long bar, and you can also use your leg to press down instead of your hand. And make sure you use a M12 12-point bolt here, because these strip, you're not going to be happy. Now that all the bolts are removed, you just have to knock it off. Well, I tried to knock the hub bearing off, and this thing came off. So I'm just going to thread the wheel bearing bolts in back from behind. Leave a little bit of a gap, and I'm just pounding on it like this on the bolt heads to help knock the bearing out from behind. And as you can see, it's working. So if your wheel bearing is having some problems coming off, just thread these bolts back in a little bit and use these to knock it out from behind. Make sure to clean this up with Scotch-Brite or emery cloth. Basically, you want this to be nice and smooth for your new wheel bearing. Okay, I've cleaned up the hub bearing surface. This thing here is a wheel speed sensor, and the speedometer and ABS system runs off of that, so be careful with that thingy. Here's my new hub bearing assembly, and always use new bolts. If your kit didn't come with new bolts, make sure you go out and buy new bolts, because these are holding the wheel onto the car. If they break, you're going to have a hard time getting them out, and if they fail while you're driving, you're going to be even more unhappy. And also make sure that you have a torque wrench and you use the correct torque values for all of these bolts, because your safety, your wheel, and your brakes are riding on these bolts. So, yeah, get a torque wrench. Many of these bolts, including these wheel bearing bolts, have a torque spec that includes plus 90 degrees or plus 180 degrees. Make sure to refer to the manual or my website where I list the torque specs. So I just use a piece of chalk, you can use a piece of paint, or even better, a torque angle wrench to figure out how far you've turned these bolts. Now, when you install the axle into your new hub bearing, I like to apply a little bit of anti-seize to these splines so that they won't be as seized in the future. And also note the torque spec. Now, there are two different kinds of bolts used on these cars. There's a 24 millimeter 12-point head and a 27 millimeter hex head with a big thick washer. So one has a washer and one doesn't, and they're also different sizes and different points. The torque specs on these are extremely different, so if you use the wrong one, you're going to mess up your new wheel bearing. So make sure to read the link in the video description below for the proper torque specs and more notes. Now, another note is when you install this wheel bolt, you're supposed to install it to the first stage torque spec, then lower the car onto the wheels. Then you can add the final torque spec, which is either a 90 degree turn or a 180 degree turn. So don't rest the car on the ground unless it has an axle installed in this wheel bearing. Otherwise, the weight of the car could deform this bearing or damage the bearing. After you've torqued this axle bolt to the first stage, lower the car into the ground so that this wheel bearing is carrying the weight of the car. And then you can torque this bolt to the final torque stage. Now, I've marked this with a piece of chalk so I know how far to turn this. Thanks for watching, and check out myturbodiesel.com and read the article linked in the video description below for my full notes on wheel bearing assembly and removal and replacement. And good luck.